My name is Nick Novicki. I'm the founder and director of the Easter Seals Disability Film Challenge. We just announced that registration just opened for our 7th annual Easter Seals Disability Film Challenge. So excited about that. I'm an actor, comedian, and producer, and I'm a really proud board member of Easter Seals Southern California. I am so excited to be here today. I don't know if you could tell by this jacket I'm wearing. It was a little tough wearing this because I put it on and my wife's like, you're going to wear that? I was like, that's a bad sign. I was like, why? Is that too much? She's like, not if you're a temptation. But I'm excited because this is Sundance. You know, everybody dresses up at Sundance. Even people that don't dress up, them not dressing up is a dressed up version of them not dressing up. So I was like, I gotta wear something special. You know, I went into Nordstrom's. I'm like, give me something that says introducing a panel or NBA All-Star Weekend. But I'm excited. I am excited to be here. And, you know, I'm feeling very lucky. I'm very lucky to be here, and I'm very lucky to where I am in my career. To date, I've been in over 40 TV shows, movies, but a lot of what I've done has been me writing, producing, creating my own content. And 7 years ago, I looked around and I was like, why aren't more people with disabilities doing this? So I launched the Disability Film Challenge, a weekend film competition where over the course of a weekend, participants write, shoot, edit, and submit 3 to 5 minute films that have somebody with a disability in front of or behind the camera. Partnering with Easter Seals Southern California really took it to the next level because to date, we've had hundreds of films, countless success stories, and ultimately we're changing the way people see disability in Hollywood. So, yay, diversity! Huh? Diversity, inclusion, these are hot topics. We hear them all the time. You know, diversity, inclusion, they're in all sectors of society, from business to schools to definitely entertainment, right? I mean, when did diversity and inclusion become cool, right? All of a sudden, it's like, you work in diversity and inclusion? Cool, come on in. Here's the red carpet. We're letting you in. You know, when did that happen? Because 7 years ago, I felt like that wasn't there. But now, it's everything. We hear it all the time. It's in every sector of entertainment. We hear it all the time. And so this panel is going to be a candid discussion where we're going to be talking about, is this going to stay cool? Or is this just a trend? Is this sustainable? Because ultimately, we want to keep seeing these stories, and it's important to us, but specifically to people with disabilities, because we're 25% of the population, and we are the most underrepresented minority population as well. And some of you guys are like, well, this is amazing, but why Easter Seals? Why is Easter Seals a part of this and throwing this diversity and inclusion panel? Well, for those of you that don't know, Easter Seals is the nation's largest disability services organization. For the last 100 years, they've been providing life-changing services to make sure that everyone is 100% included and 100% empowered. Their mission is to change the way the world views and defines disabilities. And the main reason Easter Seals is here is because a lot of times when we're talking about diversity and inclusion, even though people with disabilities are the largest minority population, we're often left out of those diversity conversations. So that's why Easter Seals Southern California, Easter Seals as a nation is here. So how about a round of applause for Easter Seals and everything they're doing? Because I told you how impactful they've been for the Easter Seals Disability Film Challenge, really bring it to the next level. You know, they're doing the same with the Media Access Awards, celebrating content and just year-round activations we're doing for workshops for Film Challenge participants. You know, I want to give a shout out and a really thank everyone here from Easter Seals, Kim, Shelley, Greg, and Nancy Weintraub and Mark Whitley. Are you here? There's Nancy, Greg, Mark Whitley, the CEO of Easter Seals, and we have Nancy is the chief development officer, and we have the national CEO of Easter Seals, Angela Williams, with us. So thank you so much. Now, are you guys ready to start this panel? All right, when I say diversity, you say, I'm just kidding. This is going to be an amazing discussion. So we have look at this panel. You're seeing really the top people in the industry that are making impact, that are making that diversity and inclusion really happen. So first off, I'd like to introduce Shanique Bonelli-Moore right here. She is the Executive Director of Inclusion for the United Talent Agency. So give a round of applause. We got the Vice President of Brand Marketing from Adobe, John Travis. He's the founder and CEO of the Blacklist, Franklin Leonard. And many of you know this amazing actress, writer, producer. You know her from Jericho, Supernatural, her groundbreaking Sundance TV, This Close, that she's the writer, star, and executive producer, and creator, and I don't know, maybe the Teamster captain? Shoshannah Stern! And our moderator, thank you so much for being here. She is the celebrity and entertainment editor for Pop Sugar, Britt Stevens. So without further ado, Britt and our panel.
Thank you so much, Nick. I think we definitely need to hear some Temptations later. Thank you guys all for joining us as we talk about diversity and inclusion in the entertainment business. Over the next 45 minutes or so, we're going to explore how the industry emphasis on D&I is changing the way we tell stories, how business practices are evolving, and how much more can be done to ensure full representation on the big and small screens. So we have, of course, our four wonderful panelists here that represent different areas of the creative community. We know many of you here today are also from different areas of the business as well, and we hope that this conversation inspires you to continue D&I efforts in your respective areas. So I want to start off by asking each of you how you think recent industry emphasis on D&I has influenced the way we tell stories. And could each of you talk about how the emphasis on D&I impacts your area of work within the business? So Shanique, let's start with you. Are agents finding more roles and opportunities for clients of diverse backgrounds? And is this emphasis affecting how the agencies are looking for talent to represent?
Sure. First, I just want to thank Easter Seals for putting this on. Very thrilled to be here. You know, I look at UTA and I see the work that we're doing, and we've always strived to represent talent with different voices that would bring unique, you know, opportunities to the stage. And I find that the work that we're doing, as we look at, you know, we talk about, oh, is this a trend or is this something that is here to stay? I see more and more of that happening. And I think there are things that are happening, you know, within our world that supports supports that. And I do feel the work that we're doing is driving that change. You know, when you look at where UTA sits, you know, we have the ability to help tell stories. We have the ability to help influence what gets made. You know, and some of my favorites that, you know, we have been involved in, Hidden Figures or The Hate U Give. You know, so we want to see more things like that. We certainly have tons of progress to go. We're just scratching the surface in many areas, but I do see that happening, yes.
Thank you. Franklin, how do you feel the work that you started at the Blacklist has influenced the industry's willingness to invest in more diverse content?
I guess the short answer would be not enough. I think that the Blacklist has sort of validated or sort of proven that the conventional wisdom that the industry uses to assess value is primarily convention and not a lot of wisdom. And that's why, for example, you know, we put out a list every year of scripts that haven't gotten made yet, and then those scripts get made and they go on to great success. And a Harvard Business School study, for example, found that over the last 15 years in the industry, movies that are made from the list make 90% more in revenue, controlling for all other factors, than movies made from not scripts on the list. But the reality is that that doesn't mean that the industry itself takes a look in the mirror and says, well, if our assumptions about what has value there were wrong, then maybe our other assumptions are wrong. Maybe our assumption that female-driven action movies don't work was wrong. Maybe the assumption that black people don't sell abroad was wrong. Maybe the assumption that, you know, there's no audience in the US for Latinx films because they're a fractured sort of demographic nationally is wrong. Maybe there's, you know, the assumption that people don't want to see movies about disabled actors is wrong. And so I think that it's, I worry quite a bit that the industry, especially from a corporate perspective, likes to say that they care about diversity and are making efforts or have made efforts over the long term to make change. But if those efforts had existed for long periods of time, I would expect to see a different result. You know, let's use Hidden Figures as an example. That was a movie written by a white woman and directed by a white man and made for a studio that was led by white people about black women. And it's great that the movie was made and made as much money as it did, but it wasn't created by the people that it was about. And I think that that's a bad thing morally and ethically and culturally, but it's also bad financially. Because if you are part of a very narrow community making content or products for the world, and you aren't allowing the world to impact the decision making about those products and that content, then you're probably not making optimal economic decisions from a business perspective, and your business is not as successful as it can be. And I think if you look at most of the companies in the industry, they'd be doing a lot better if they were run by more diverse people. And the people that are currently running them obviously have no incentive to make that change, because that would mean that they'd be shown the door.
That was a word, thank you. So, Shoshannah, as an actor, are you seeing more roles being played by individuals with a disability? And what has your experience been with auditions and finding roles that you want to play?
Yeah, those are two separate questions, really. Is there change? Absolutely. Yeah, there is change. I've seen various changes, exciting changes. Yep, Ali Stroker, for example. Lola Spencer, for example. Lauren Kraloff. I mean, these are people, and Shella Mann. I mean, they are getting real exciting roles and fantastic opportunities. However, what bothers me as a person is that they are framed as the first, right? What first really means is only, you know? And so we will always have people that who don't feel represent, who they're not representing. People are people, and they're not, you know, they're not minivans, right? They can't include everyone in their minivan. You know, the community is a wide spectrum of people that people need to be shown. And I feel like, yes, just like Frankenstein, often people, you know, are like, wow, we have these people, but you need to have more of them to make sure that the door is open and it's not just one person, here's the token. It's not enough. And so, sorry, second question. The audition process. So auditioning, yes, absolutely. I think things do pop up more and more. But again, just like you said, it's not enough. You know, one in four people identify themselves as having a disability, but only 5 to 8% of the characters in films on TV have a disability. And so that 5 to 8%, 95 to 99% are played by able-bodied people. Yeah, absolutely. And so we still, it's not enough. You know, change is there, but we need more emphasis. We need more of a way to push that out.
Thank you. So, John, how has Adobe evolved its software to be more inclusive? And what types of content creators now have access to your products that maybe wouldn't have a few years ago?
Yeah, so we recently made a change in our business. We used to be a box software company, and we used to be a company really targeting creative professionals very narrowly. And over the last years, we moved to a subscription-based business. Over 50% of the customers coming into Adobe now are new to the company. We have the largest network of creatives around the world, hundreds of millions of creative customers. We call them the community. But I think, let me just start with Adobe itself, because I really agree with all three panelists. Before I talk about the film industry, we have to talk about the technology industry, which is pretty much in the same situation, where we have an enormously diverse customer base, and how can we best serve them if we're not reflecting their makeup? And we're not, and we know it. And so first and foremost, how software is changing, I think diversity and inclusion at our company has become paramount. It's, to Franklin's point, it's actually a business imperative. It's also an imperative for our talent and employees. You know, 90% of Gen Z now, the younger generation that is coming up, they expect companies that they do business with to contribute to the social good and environmental sustainability. It's absolutely critical. And so we have to change ourselves first. And we're really focused on that. And, you know, just like the film industry, so some examples of how we're changing, you know, we're completely overhauling our sort of talent recruitment. You made that point, how we're interviewing. We have a program called Digital Academy, which we launched a few years ago, which is basically how do we bring in adults that are from less traditional backgrounds, people who aren't typically go into technology careers, kind of started in engineering, but now we're expanding it to video and interactive design, bringing them into the company. And those are examples, people of color, people with disabilities, Native indigenous people, veterans, we're really trying to bring in. And what we're finding is great opportunity for them, but what an asset for us. They have 96% retention at Adobe. The people have come into our company because of that. But it's like barely the tip of the iceberg of what we need to do. So we really recognize that enormously. We're not going to be successful if we don't change. And so, you know, it's frustrating because it's slow. It feels very slow. You know, we just announced we have now 100% global pay parity at the company. There's no more pay gap between men and women at Adobe around the world. That's great. But again, that's like one thing, okay? So there's a ton more to do, and we recognize that.
Right. Just will also add, you know, so when you think about the employee base, because ultimately these are the people who are working on behalf of the company to, whether it's make movies, whether it's to produce or create. And, you know, I think there's lots of work being done to support, you know, how do we attract talent that represents the world we live in, right? Whether it is you're recruiting in different places, you're providing access to resources and tools that some people may not have access to. And so that's great, and I think we've made some progress there. Tons more to do because there's lots of barriers for entry as folks are coming into the organization, but I'd like to maybe just focus a little bit about what do we do when we have employees in the door, right? So how do we keep them? And so how do we build community and sense of belonging so that people can show up to work as their authentic selves and deliver the work that they have to do? In order for you to even do that, you need to at least be in a place where you feel that you can thrive. And so we've been working across the organization to create what we call our employee inclusion groups that support and drive inclusion and sense of belonging across the entire corporation. And so we have what we call UTA Proud, which is a group that supports LGBTQ activism and awareness. We have a group that's focused on wellness, you know, that speaks to not only physical fitness, but mental health as well, right? We have our unity group that's focused on multicultural voices, and then we also have our women's group. And so these are the four groups we started at the onset. We're looking to expand and grow those groups, but these are the types of things that we're looking to at least build community, because we found that people, you know, they get here, but then they're leaving for a variety of reasons, and so how could we make their experiences at the company that much greater?
So my father is in his 70s, and he grew up in West Central Georgia, and he was in the Army for 25 years, and he was sort of prone to these very annoying aphorisms when I was a kid. He would say things like, you know, piss poor planning on your part does not create an emergency on mine. Yeah, when I was like 7 and forgot my soccer shoes at home, I was like, please go get my soccer shoes. And that was the answer. But the one that he said that has really stuck with me and that I will definitely use with my own children is, don't tell me your priorities, show me your budget. So what I'd love to hear from all of us is how much money our companies are spending on these programs that are supposed to be addressing these problems that we say we believe make us more money, and yet the solutions are affinity groups internally. They are trying to expand the customer base into different demographics, but not the product engineers that are making those products. And there doesn't appear to be a great deal of financial investment in that. Now, I was actually at UTA speaking on a panel several weeks ago, and the subject of entry-level compensation came up. I believe the entry-level compensation at CAA is currently minimum wage in California, $15 an hour. I could be wrong. I mean, if I'm wrong, you can tell me.
I don't work at UTA. I mean, CAA, so I don't know.
No,
that
UTA.
Number. Oh, UTA.
UTA. CAA actually just raised their entry-level employee compensation. UTA, I believe, is minimum wage.
We have competitive salary and benefits that we provide for employees, so I wouldn't want to... Look, I know that the numbers aren't where they're supposed to be, and I think that there are lots of ways that we can look at how we look at compensation and benefits. So I'd like to speak more about what we've done in addition to that piece. We have provided commuter benefits for our assistants. In fact, all our employees, we have provided really competitive, you know, medical, dental, stock options, year-end bonuses, et cetera. And so there are things that, you know, I think we would look at this holistically. Are we done? No, we're not. But I think we have to look at the full package and the full picture. And so I'm not going to sit here and pat ourselves on the back and say, oh, yeah, we're done with this. No, but I also have to think about what else can we do to make that a better picture with respect to compensation.
Right. I guess my point is, and this is obviously not limited to UTA, but it's a broader problem in the industry, though a number of agencies, UTA not included yet, but I assume that it will happen shortly, have increased their base pay for entry-level employees above the current California minimum wage of $15 an hour. The problem there is, if you are trying to recruit talented people of color, people with disabilities, people from any number of minority communities, those same people are getting competitive offers from the tech community, from the banking world, from any number of other opportunities that are 3, 4, 5x the entry-level compensation of the industry. As a consequence, you end up with an entry-level population of the industry that is disproportionately from significantly better than upper-middle-class economic backgrounds, which, and as we know, race can often be a proxy for class in America, means that you have less representation in any number of representative groups when we're talking about entering the industry, to say nothing of getting promoted at the various levels of it. So I think it's really important that if we're going to talk about a desire to increase the representation that exists in our boardrooms, in our employee groups, on screen, that we be sincere when we talk about how committed are we to this change? Are we willing to pay our assistants $1 an hour more? $5 an hour more? Are we willing to compensate them competitively with the jobs that are going to be offered? If we're not, we're not being serious about trying to expand the representation that exists in our business. It is just lip service designed to cover our ass during a period where D&I is really important, but it's not a financial priority, and it's really difficult to believe that you believe that you can make money from doing it if you're not investing money in trying to get a return on that investment.
Thank you. That was great. So Franklin, I want to stay with you, but I want to touch on something that Nick mentioned in his intro about the trend of D&I. And do you think this emphasis on D&I is a trend, or is it a push for, is this push for authenticity sustainable? And I want to start with you, because you obviously see so many stories with the Blacklist. So what stories are getting produced or not produced?
I believe that it is not a trend, but I don't believe that it is not a trend because the corporations that historically have run Hollywood are emphasizing it or are making change. I believe that it is not a trend because of the proliferation of opportunities for storytellers to tell their stories on any number of different platforms. Historically, there were 5 studios, 3 networks, and access to those 5 studios and those 3 networks and the resources that were required to make content that could be put on them were controlled by a few agencies. If you didn't have access to them, you didn't have access to that. Now, I don't need an agency to get my work to any number of the studios, independent financiers, streaming platforms. I don't need an agency, I don't need a studio, I don't need a streamer to make something on my phone that's dope and put it out to an audience of literally a billion people online. And if someone ever gets around to building an actual sort of infrastructure that allows people to be reliably compensated without the risk of piracy, we won't need any of that infrastructure in order to make content that could be distributed widely, right? So as the sort of stranglehold that the traditional companies that have run Hollywood begins to loosen, they are sort of faced with a question. We can either begin to get our act together and fix this, or we're going to be irrelevant and left behind. So I don't give any of the companies that run Hollywood credit for figuring it out. I give them credit for saying, yeah, we should probably give Ryan Coogler a movie to direct if we want to make money. But I give Ryan Coogler that credit. I give Ava DuVernay that credit. I give Barry Jenkins that credit. I give Shoshana that credit. And the fact of the matter is, if they don't keep pace, someone else will, the macros of the world and Charles King, And they will make a lot of money. Like, one of the things that I love about the industry's failure to actually adapt rapidly to a changing world is that it creates a massive business opportunity for me and the rest of us who actually understand what's going on.
Thank you. Dee, I...
Wow.
I attended a panel yesterday, and Dee Reese, Mudbound director, was talking about the same thing as far as, you know, bringing her projects to Netflix and just how she was able to bring that project to so many more people and also didn't have to deal with the BS with the large studios. Yeah. So thank you.
Very quickly on Netflix, because it's fascinating. If you look at Netflix's first major Oscar campaigns, right, like The Irishman, obviously not diverse. But look, I love the movie. It's not. That's a fact. But if you look at their first big campaigns, right, it was Mudbound, it was Beasts of No Nation, and it was 13th. And then When They See Us. How many other studios do you know in the last 3 decades who have invested heavily in a campaign for non-white male creators? Because there aren't any. Spoiler. And they did it in 5 years, yeah. Right? And here's the other thing. Netflix's whole business model is, we're looking at the numbers to make our business decisions. If they're looking at the numbers and they're choosing to do a lot of diverse content, what does that say about what the studios are looking at to make their decisions?
Yeah.
Probably not the numbers.
Right. And speaking of talent, Shanique, do you think there's an adequate pipeline for talent to help fuel this more inclusive storytelling?
There's talent. There's talent everywhere. I think the question is what's, you know, the access to the talent. So, you know, when I think about, you know, the Blacklist, the Macros of the world, I'm with it, you know, because I do feel there's a gap that was there that is still there that you guys are helping. And I think when you look at it, we all are looking to hire and find great talent. And so for me, I think there is way more pipeline. I think we need to get to them and get them to work.
And John, from your perspective, do you see technology that supports storytelling? Is it continuing to evolve?
Absolutely, and I want to just comment on the conversation you two had,
because
I feel like it is a multifaceted, and I totally agree with you. I feel like we need to really invest in the problem, and I think every company could do a whole lot more. At Adobe, in the last 5 years, we've donated $150 million worth of software. We have a network of 45,000 nonprofits that we work with. We have a special youth. Our focus is really on youth and diverse youth and education. Is it enough? Could we do more? Absolutely. But I think it's always been kind of an element. But then to your point, I feel like it goes beyond money. You got to have the money. I totally agree with you. But we also do a lot of things that are less obvious, like employee volunteerism. So at Adobe, 70% of our employees are engaged in local community volunteerism, and most of that has to do with helping young, underserved kids in creativity and technology. And so I agree with both of your points that I feel like you really do need to invest in the problem. I'm sure Adobe could be investing more. I'm not applauding Adobe right now. I'm just saying that is a focus, but it's a multifaceted problem. Yes, go ahead.
I was going to let you finish, but I do want to talk to Shoshannah about this as well.
I was just going to say that the software will continue to evolve. You know, I think people with disabilities is another huge focus for our company that I feel like over the years we haven't been as focused on. I'm not a designer, but I know that an entire very large training program has gone to every single designer at our company to think about people with disabilities and bring them on board. I don't know a ton about that, but we're trying to do that. Also, just the explosion of mobile. You know, we came out with Photoshop on iPad, Premiere, our editing software, Premiere Rush, which is mobile, really trying to open it up so that people really have an opportunity who want to create. So we have a ton more to do, but I feel like we're working on it.
Yeah. Can I just go quickly?
Yeah, please.
So do you think actors from underrepresented backgrounds are going to need to continue to create their own content, or are you seeing the industry being at least a little more proactive in the types of content they're producing?
Right. They are a little bit more proactive, but not enough. Whereas actors from any background and community can sit back and think that they will still have a place at the table. You know, for them, absolutely not. I think on the outside, it's easy to see people working. Oh, look, there we are, you know, but if we think often, like for me, I can't remember the last time I got a job from an actual audition. I mean, I'm lucky enough to find people who are willing to collaborate with me or who are able to be able to create my own work. And so really, I still feel like there's not a place at the table for me. And so I make my own content. And so I make my own table. And so I have to. And so everyone really needs to make their own table. And that is still a fact. But I feel like representation, people, you know, it has to be visible, people thinking that that has to be the case, but that's not true. What matters is, what's divisible, right? It means what's behind the camera, what you can't see. The reputation in front of the camera, obviously people are pushing themselves. We have to be aware. You know, we want to see people. But when I go onto the set, the crew, for example, I mean, the creative team, it's still overwhelming white, male, able-bodied people. And so really, and we need to create more opportunities for people who are from minority groups and communities, especially deaf people. Only 52% of deaf people in America have employment. And so we try to hire 25 people, that are deaf behind and in front of the camera, but in session two of this close. And it sounds like a lot, but really it's not. It's not enough. And so people are still looking at the experience and, what are they? Are they in, the WGA? Are they doing all of these things? But no, because they can't, And so we're trying to create a chair for them and encouraging them. And so if you get a place at the table, you need to make sure that the table is big enough for everybody.
Thank you. Did you want to follow up?
Yeah. It sort of just echoes that idea, and I think maybe I wasn't clear enough. When I talk about investment in these issues, I'm not talking about volunteerism. I'm not talking about philanthropy. What I'm talking about is, are you making financial investments to change the way your business is functioning? Are you making competitive offers to possible future employees to make them choose to work for you so that you can make the money you claim you believe exists with increased diversity and inclusion? It is all fine and good to say we want to train our employees to think about our customers and the full range of our customers, but if your customers and all of the different customers are not part of the people making the products, you're going to end up with a situation like they did with the sort of the automatic hand dryers, where dark-skinned black people didn't activate it because all the people that made it were white. And they never said, oh, right, if your hand's a little darker, it should probably work for you too. So you're making suboptimal products for your business because you don't have that diversity in-house. And if you're not investing in improving the diversity in your company, you are failing as corporate leaders. Like, I can't be clear enough about that. And again, yes, it's about morals and ethics. That's fine, that's important. But if you can't do the right thing for the right reasons, do it for the wrong ones. Make that money.
I wanna circle back. Oh.
Can I add something really quick? I'm sorry to interrupt.
Please.
But I agree with you 100%, and I think that the words, even words matter. Titles are important. Like behind the scenes with a creative process, people from minority communities are called consultants.
Good point.
ASL master or coach. And we're hiring an ASL master of someone who is able to look at the sign language for the camera. And our ASL master, she said absolutely not. Her name is Alexandria. She's just a fantastic person. Anyway, she does a lot of work with the union and in New York. And so she's changing the titles to Director of Artistic Sign Language. And that title matters. Now she sits next to the director. She's able to go, they're equal, they're colleagues. Before, the ASL master would be way in the background, sitting in somewhere else, or consultant, oh, thank you, but still, it's my project, cool to know. They're like tokenism, right? They're involved in it as a token. And so really, you need to empower other people, and by empowerment, doesn't make you weaker, right? It makes the project stronger, honestly.
Thank you so much for adding that. The consultant thing is, it's so true. So just to kind of wrap things up, Shanique, I'll start with you. What recommendations do you have on how together, all of us, can encourage this sustainability of D&I in the industry? Obviously, I think we all know, we're never going to be done. We all have so much work to do, and we have to work together. So how do you think we can continue to push this forward so that it doesn't, you know, die out as this trend.
Right, so there's something that I like to say and do, you know, so we're here and we're at this forum, and I think this is great because I think this brings us together. We're able to talk and converse, you know, learn from each other. So I love the idea of best practice sharing, or, you know, Franklin's point, you know, like if you, you know, whatever your motivation, right, let's get it done. And so I like these forums where we can get together and discuss, but, you know, more so you just have to do it, right? You just have to really be about it. And so when I think about the role that I play at UTA, I know there's so many things that I want to do, and I know that I have to pace myself because, one, it's not going to happen overnight. You know, we have lots of work to do. Like, the reason why I took this role is because of the opportunity that does exist to close these gaps. And so I'm not going to sit here and say, oh my goodness, you know, UTA, we are, yes, let me toot our own horns. That's not why I took the job. I fundamentally believe in this work, and I really want to be the person that is the catalyst to kind of spark change, to change behaviors, to help people understand. So all the things that we're talking about on this screen or on this panel, I understand and I know it to be true, but now people still don't get it. So how can we work collectively as an industry, as a community, to change the opinions and minds of people? And that's not gonna happen until, one, more people begin talking about it, more people begin doing it, and as we see, you know, let's see what the numbers tell us. Let's look at the data, and clearly it shows that there's a place for everybody in this industry to do great work and to tell great stories and to help change and influence culture. So I just want to be about the work, and I'm looking forward to partnering with everyone on this stage and folks in the audience to kind of help me along the way. And if there is a moment where we can be doing something better, I want to take that feedback. I want to be open to that constructive feedback that will help drive change, because I know it's not easy. And the more people that can say it, that gives me validation and all my data points to say, hey, we have to do this. And so that's what I see the role that I play at UTA.
John, go ahead.
So I'm going to get a little personal here because I'm starting to sound like my mother. It's really frightening. But So I grew up as a gay kid a long time ago. Like, I'm older than a lot of people on this panel. The forgotten Gen X, just so you know, the Winona Ryder generation. Okay.
I'm with you on Gen X.
All right.
I'm with you on Gen
hey.
X.
Okay.
Reality Bites, critical movie.
Okay. So anyway, so I grew up in an era where, like, I saw nobody. I saw no stories that represented me. And if I did, they were overwhelmingly negative.
Yeah.
Like, so negative. And in fact, it was like the love that dare not speak its name. You couldn't even bring it up. Okay? So the thing that I learned that I want to just impart on you, which maybe is more life than diversity, is that I have to keep learning. And if I want to work on this, then I need to really educate myself. The minute you think that you know it all, that you know what this person is going through, you know nothing. Because I grew up at a time where I had to hide a lot of who I was. So I don't know. I don't make any assumptions about anybody because I don't know what you're going through. And so let me give you two examples. So at Adobe, I'm a mentor. I mentor, and I really focus on diverse young people coming to the company. I learn so much more from them. They don't know this. I learn so much more from them than what they learn from me. You have no idea how much I learn from them. And I still don't know nearly enough. Somebody mentioned earlier the documentary Crip Cramp, which I was fortunate enough to see in the opening. And I was so woefully, and here I am, you know, I'm running diversity and I'm focusing on people with disabilities. I had no idea the extent to which of that battle, an ongoing battle about basic human rights. But more than that, I didn't really understand, and I still, I'm not saying I am an expert at all, but basic issues that never entered my mind, like if I am a disabled person in a wheelchair, or if I have cerebral palsy, the right to privacy. Mm-hmm. Privacy is something that's so important. That would never entered my mind, okay? I'm learning all the time. Thank God that films like that are being made, because film is so powerful. So my advice, or counsel, which is also my mother's, is keep learning, because you don't know what people are going through. Don't make assumptions. Keep learning, discussing, talking, going to things like this. And that's kind of my commitment of all the things we're doing and all the programs. What's most important to me, because I came to, this is my, what, fifth or sixth time at Sundance. I learned so much every time. And that's my advice to everybody.
Thank you. We're gonna go to our Q&A now. Nancy is going to be running around, so please raise your hands if you have any questions.
Hi, my name is Michael. I'm a deafblind film critic from Toronto, Canada. And I just have to say something really quick and then I'll follow up with a question. I wanted to study film studies, but I could not because they didn't have any captioning. I also wanted to be an actor, but many acting coaches didn't answer my calls or just failed to respond. And some of them even left after one acting lesson because they didn't know how to communicate with me. And furthermore, I wanted to be a film critic, and that's why I'm here. But I also struggled with finding captioning or accessible formats, including QuipCamp, unfortunately, which the captioning failed yesterday. So what I want to say, though, is to make the point that when you've had a door shut in your face, it's hard to let that go. It's hard to forget. Because every time you experience it again, you just remember what happened before. And I would like all of you on the panel to pay particular attention to educating people with disabilities. Because if I can't study film studies and if I can't, you know, get the education that I require, then I'm going to be less qualified to get those jobs that you guys are talking about. Thank you for listening to me.
Hi, Sultan Shroof here with the Quasar Lab, a hacked lab that was created at MIT. I wanted to see what you guys think about the role or increasing role of algorithms and algorithmic bias, particularly in this sort of streaming world that we're in, and how that relates to what's getting funded, particularly when you get corrupt data streams, right, where we have reductive algorithms. You mentioned Netflix earlier, but you know it won't recommend, and I'm a filmmaker as well and support filmmakers of color, it won't recommend oftentimes movies by filmmakers of color if you haven't yet watched one, right? So down to the design of these algorithms, yep. And then if you read the report then, like at Netflix or at Amazon or now Disney and Apple, et cetera, it'll say, oh, these people like these types of movies, right? But there are all these amazing award-winning movies from all over the world that don't get seen because they're never getting recommended. So I wonder if you guys can speak about how in your particular fields you're seeing that play out in this diversity and inclusion conversation.
Yeah, so I'm a bit of a algorithm junkie. Like, I'm fascinated by this stuff, and I was going to be a math major in college. Like, I'm that kid. And look, garbage in, garbage out, right? And I think that it's really important that if you're going to sort of embrace this notion of algorithmic recommendation, you need to make sure that it is good algorithmic recommendation. And I actually don't know that I buy the idea that if you haven't watched a black movie, you're not going to get recommended one. Because I've done a pretty deep dive into like the Netflix algorithm, sort of coming out of the Netflix Prize era. And a lot of it has to do with sort of decomposing matrices and a lot that have nothing to do whatsoever with even knowledge of whether the movie is black or not. It's just, you know, here's everything you like, here's everything else that everyone else that has ever used our platform has liked. Based on the things you have in common that you've watched, we can predict these scores for the things that you would also like, and therefore these are our top recommendations for you, right? So, but again, I think that this is why it's important that you have diverse people involved in building the algorithm, so they can check you when you're like, you know, it's weird. You seem to like films that are built into three separate stories that have really lush visuals, and it recommends In the Mood for Love, but doesn't recommend, or you know, it recommends you know, Hush and Schweiz movies, but doesn't recommend Moonlight. Right? Like, that would be a failure of the algorithm, and maybe you should go back and look at how you built the algorithm, because maybe it's garbage. And so again, I just think that's why it's important that the people that are building these products are representative of the world in which we live. Otherwise, you're not going to get the best thing you could have. I also think that those algorithms also need to build into them more discovery. I think that's actually another big failure of the recommendations engines, is that they're, you know, sort of driven by things you've already watched and everything everybody else has watched, and doesn't push you in new directions, which I think is part of one of the things that most people like about watching movies and television. But it's a much bigger conversation, and I think that, again, the solution is have a diverse team building your stuff.
Yeah. Thank you.
As a starting place.
We have a question in the front here.
Right here.
Perfect.
Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for being on the panel. My name is Chandra, and I'm a director of an art and disability organization locally, and I'm deaf. I'm so excited to see all of you.
Yeah, I'm excited to see you too.
So one question that I have, so we talk about representation in the industry, and if someone doesn't go and see a movie, then they're not going to want to work in the industry, right? They're not going to have that drive to be an actor or be a director and so forth. And so we still have just a huge amount of barriers connected to captioning and access for the deaf and the deafblind, and audio description also for the blind. So, I mean, even this festival still has challenges. So when I chatted with the theaters and the film organizers and such, they tend to say, well, the filmmakers that make that film, they say, well, you know, we didn't know that that was an option to create the audio description and captioning. So there seems to be kind of finger pointing and a blame game going on, and no one's taking accountability and responsibility. So I'm curious for you up there on the stage, what are you doing to make sure that your films are accessible? Are you bringing in equipment, the captioning equipment? I mean, what are you bringing in? I mean, what can the theaters and the organizations and the filmmakers do? I mean, everyone can be involved, but tell me how you're contributing to the accessibility of the industry.
And I think it's everyone. I think first time I came here, I think it was 2008, with a project, and I was an actor within it, and hadn't started writing or producing yet, but the film was not captioned, and I was in it. And I did, you know, ask, hey, but it's the same response, the same conversation. I think people are afraid to take responsibility. I think people are afraid to say, you know, oh, I don't know about this. This, you know, it's a problem with our society in general. People are afraid to be vulnerable. They're afraid to say, wow, I didn't know about that. Please tell me more. Really simple solutions, I think. And, you know, when I brought my film here, well, first of all, there's a web series and then episodic, but we wanted to make sure that it was captioned, but honestly, because most of it was in sign language. And so people on the other side of thing, people who never had to think about accessibility before, all of a sudden had to think, oh, wait, it's not accessible to me. Now I get it. And so I feel like, you know, more people need their work to be seen, and more people need, like, you know, someone who's going to say, you know, once you get past, you know, the maker. So there's a man who just won Golden Globe. He said that when you overcome 1 inch of a barrier, you know, you tend to have so many more movies that you can do. So you have more content. You think once people are placed within our position, they go, oh, it's not accessible to me. And then finally they understand it. And they need to make it personal for everyone in order to make that change.
Thank you. Okay, we have time for one more question. Let's go here in the front. Oh, okay. I'm sorry about that.
Hi. Excuse me. My name is Kia Brown, and I am a journalist and a creative. And my question really revolves around what happens after you buy the film you're making. So I find that as a disabled Black woman, like you said earlier, I have never seen myself represented. So often when we see these films, it's about white disabled men who hate themselves, or they come into disability and they think so much about the lives they had before. But for someone like me who was born with my cerebral palsy, I'm watching these films and I'm thinking, okay, you made the film, but it's doing more harm than it is good. So my question is, what are the specifics of what you're going to do when you find these films to make sure that they're not doing harm to the community that you're representing? Because what does it say to the rest of us that, one, our stories don't matter, and two, we must absolutely hate ourselves in these bodies? And I don't hate myself in my body. So what I want to know is, what are you going to do when you find these films and you want to fund them and you want them to be a part of your studio to make sure that they're not films that are exploitative or harmful to the rest of the community?
Woo! Yes.
Thank you. I'm not sure which one of you wants to speak to that, but I think that's an amazing question.
Yeah. I mean, I might have the most sort of proximate relationship right, to that with the Blacklist and the movies. I think it's important that you are represented as part of the process in making the movie and putting it into the world. You know, and this is something that I've been struggling with myself. You know, the Blacklist has been involved in a number of different movies that come from a number of different perspectives. And in dealing with studios that are going to release them, it's been made very apparent to me that that's not necessarily a priority to them. And, you know, then it's incumbent upon me and then the rest of my team and everyone that I have any responsibility for to do the extra labor to make sure that it does. But I just, look, the thing that I'm frustrated by, and I'm going to sort of go back to Crip Camp, and I'm just going to say point blank, if you guys haven't seen this movie, make every effort to see it. I don't care if you're a member of the community with people with disabilities or not. I left that movie sort of covered in tears, first of all. And then second of all, really angry, because that story, which is an important part of American history, and the work that the people whose story was told benefits all of us. And I also want to give a shout out to Judy Heumann, who's here, who's basically my new hero. But like, I just think it's important that someone said recently, like, nothing about us without us. And I think that that's a really good guideline. I'm not a big believer in rules, but I do think that, like, your work's going to be better for it. And so, at a minimum, make the extra effort to make sure that happens. And I can make the commitment that that will be something that I will try to do. I will still fail, and I hope that every single one of you here checks me on it the second that I do, because I will want the feedback, and I will try to adjust course. I think that's the only way any of us can move forward. And I also think it's really important. Look, I've gone pretty hard on this stage, even at my fellow panelists. And I think it's really important, though, that like we all have different sort of positions that we play in this, but ultimately we are all teammates. And some of our positions are a heck of a lot more difficult than others. It is really easy for me to sit here as the owner of my own company without an employer to say what I say. Meanwhile, you are in the belly of the beast, fighting the fight, and having to then come on this stage and talk about these issues as a representative of your company and as a representative of yourself. That is a more difficult position than I am in and will ever be in. And I think that it is really important that we that are on the outside of this stuff do what we can do to support the people who are on the inside who are fighting the same fight that we are and make sure that we give them all of the support that they need to fight that fight. So whether it's additional information that they may not have, whether it's additional receipts so they can make that argument to their boss, whether it's voting with our dollar and paying to go see these movies so that when she goes in and talks to her bosses about the need for more diverse agents because they need more diverse talent, she can say, look how much money all these things are making. These folks are not going to be adequately represented by the folks we currently have in-house. I need more money to recruit those people. That's what y'all can do to make her job easier. And it's important that we all play our position and we are all good teammates, which means checking people when we're wrong, myself included, but bigging them up when we know that they are fighting hard in ways that we can't necessarily understand. And I think that that is part and parcel of all of this, because none of us get free until we're all free.
Thank you. I think, do we have time for one more question? Or
Judy wants to make a comment.
Okay, we got a comment over here. We got one quick comment. Who saw Crip Camp, by the way?
Can we?
Well, those of you that know, and everyone in the room should know, we have a legend right here, Judy Heumann. Really.
So, I would just like to make a comment following up on what Kia Brown just said. I think it's really important to follow up also what Kurt said about learning, because I do believe that many non-disabled people do believe that it is better to be dead than alive. Mm-hmm. And so when these kinds of films are being produced, I think the learning hasn't gone on. Yeah. And I think that's really what we're talking about. People themselves as non-disabled people or who may have hidden disabilities or whatever it may be, who are afraid to come forward because they're afraid that something negative may happen to them or whatever. There needs to be some serious discussion. Yeah. because the message, not just in the United States, but around the world, and significantly in many other countries, is to have a disability is a tragedy. It is better dead. It's better to be dead than not. Yeah. And in order to be able to produce what we're talking about, I really believe we have to look and learn from other people, disabled people with diverse backgrounds, et cetera.
Yeah. Wow. Well, I don't think there's any better closure to our panel right there than Judy, right? One more round of applause. The learning is going to keep going through the Easter Seals Disability Film Challenge, through everything that we're doing collectively, but through these people right here that are really making that effort. Can we give them a round of applause, all our panelists? And Franklin and Judy, maybe you guys are running for president together in the...
I wanted to ask her afterwards whether she'd ever consider running for office, because she would definitely have my vote.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much. And the good news is, this is a reception after. We're going to be hanging out. The discussion's going to continue. We have chili, so that's fun. So let's keep learning, connecting, and networking together. Thank you so much, everybody.